as trials and temptation. Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation. But we can lay our burdens down. Everybody has fears, everybody got worry. Everybody knows sorrow, devastation.
To welcome you this morning to Community Evangelical Church. We're glad you're here. We have a lot going on today, but hopefully as we worship together today, you will just have an encounter with the living God. That's our prayer, that God would meet us here and that you would, as you worship him, that you would just sense his presence and that he would be honored by our worship this morning. In your bulletin is a bright green card that looks like that. It's a connection card. If you're visiting with us today for the first time, we want to welcome you as our guest. We're glad you're here. Hope you especially enjoy the service. We'd ask everybody that's here, though, to fill that out. Share with us any information that we need to know. We'd love to have our guests share with us, you know, some contact information just so we can send you a thank you for worshiping with us today. And on the back, there's a place there for you to write prayer requests, concerns, questions. Tomorrow morning as a staff, we'll meet together and we pray for every one of those prayer requests. So we encourage you to do that, take that opportunity. A couple of things as we begin our service that we want to remind you of. One of the things that's so very important to us as a church is connecting with one another, doing life together, sharing our experiences together, and just walking this Christian life together. And one of the best ways we can do that is through small groups, connecting in life groups, Bible study groups, just as we just go through the difficulties of life, to have people that we can interact with is so very important. And so we want to encourage all of you to get connected to a group. Some of you already are, some of you are not. And so if you're not in a group right now, we would like to encourage you to get in a group. And the best way to do that this morning is as soon as the service is done, if you go back to the fellowship room, there is representatives from most of our groups here this morning. So you can just kind of go around, look at the different groups, see when they meet, see who's part of that group, and find a group that you can connect with that would be helpful to your walk with Christ. You can sign up there. The leaders of the group will get in touch with you. You can join those groups, and we just encourage you to do that. I want to remind you that next Sunday, we return to our normal worship schedule. So if you show up at 10 o'clock, you'll come right in the middle of a worship service. So next Sunday, we go back to our 8, 9:30, and 11 o'clock schedule. Three services next week. Children's ministries happen during the 9:30 service. So if you have young people who need to be in children's ministry or youth ministry, that happens at 9:30. But just mark that on your calendar. Again, next Sunday, we go back to that regular schedule. The week after that, on September 1st, we have a special group going to be with us. The Teen Challenge Choir is going to be here doing some special music that day. So I invite you to be a part of that Sunday, and we'll have an opportunity to mingle with them a little bit and get to know them. And we also want to let you know our Men of Iron and Lineage of Love groups are starting up again this fall. We have new classes that will be starting on October 27th. So there's sign-ups in the lobby. That's just a one-on-one mentoring program. So think about that, pray about that, and you can get more information there. One of the things we love as community church that God has given us the opportunity to do is to connect with the community around us and reach out to people who would probably never step foot in the doors of our church. And one of the ways that God has blessed us with the opportunity to do that is through Triple Tree Ministries. And so I'm going to invite Larry Bentz to come forward. Larry is a longtime member of community. He's part of Triple Tree. And so this morning, we invited Larry to just share a little bit about what's going on with Triple Tree. We're going to ask him to share maybe some of his ability to be second best. And so go ahead, share with us this morning.
So, hi, I'm Lar. My road name's Gunner. For those of you that don't know about Triple Tree Ministries, Triple Tree Ministries is a motorcycle ministry in which we minister to the motorcycle community at large, but our primary focus is to minister to the outlaw or 1% motorcycle clubs in the area. Triple Tree is, oh, well, so you know how you always have that one friend. So I thought it would be really cool when I was in Israel that I would get my cut and show it in front of the Dome of the Rock, right? But we all have that one friend that if you have an F-150, he has an F-250. If you have a six-cylinder, he has an eight-cylinder. Well, that my friend did actually wore the cut on the grounds of the Dome of the Rock, just to one-up me with the risk of an international incident. I was really proud of that.
Hey, go big or go home.
Yeah. So said the Michigan to Penn State. Anyway, I'm sorry. It's Tourette's. It just came out.
That's all right.
So this is...
We should compare the records. I'm just saying.
Okay. We do not have time for this. Karen is going like this. So anyhow, that's the crew of Triple Tree Ministries, and my brothers and sisters in Christ in the ministry are sitting over there in their cuts. So we all dress like bikers, well, because we are, but later on into the service, Mike is going to talk about surrounding yourself with godly friends, and I can tell you every one of them is rock solid, and I am blessed to have you, call you brothers and sisters and friends. Yeah. Bikers aren't supposed to cry, I'm just saying. So
what? You will always cry. Like it's
stop.
Rare for you to
stop. They don't need to know that. Okay, they don't need to know that.
We won't tell anyone that, but it's true. So okay, so we'll just pause for a second because okay. I'm going to ask you what's going on
right.
in Triple Tree, where you're headed. But one of the things that that we all need to be aware of is that Triple Tree is really ministering to some just really amazing opportunities that most of us will never experience. And so just for the sake of our people who are involved in Triple Tree, we broadcast our services live, but we're going to go ahead and disconnect the audio. So if you're online, disconnect. that's a great opportunity to go and support Triple Tree and what they're doing and their impact, really in places and in ways that you and I, most of us in this room, would never be able to do. And so we're just super excited about what God is doing and the opportunities that he is opening up because you're willing to be the hands and feet of Jesus and show the love of Jesus to people who need it. So thank you. And thank you to the Triple Tree team as well. You guys are awesome. We want to worship God today. I'm gonna pray for Triple Tree. So you can stay up here as I pray. I'm going to pray for Triple Tree, but also pray that God would just meet us here today in this place. God, thanks for Larry and Rev and Frau and the whole team of Triple Tree. God, thank you for their willingness to make themselves uncomfortable so that they could love people who need Jesus. God, thank you for the doors that you've opened up because of your love. We pray that you continue to bless their ministry, continue to equip them through the power of your Spirit, and continue to transform lives there. Father, may each and every one of us in this room gain a desire and a passion to reach outside of our comfort zones in order to love people. We love you. We're so grateful for what you're doing. It's because you are a God who cares deeply about us. It's because you're a God who has chosen us as his very own. It's because you're a God who loves us intimately and interacts with us daily that we have gathered this morning because we want to express our love back to you. And so as we meet in this place, we invite your Spirit to freely move among us, to awaken us, to excite us. And God, may we, from the depths of our heart, give our praise and worship to you today. Take this time and do what you want to do, God, and what only you can do. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I encourage you now to stand. Say hello to those who are worshiping with you this morning. Yeah, they did. After you.
Glad you're here, and that if you are visiting and worshiping with us for the first time, we're so glad you came. Before we started, I just wanted to ask us a question. I was on a long ride yesterday home, coming back to my house, and I was listening to a radio station where the particular interviewer was talking about a conversation he'd had with a local pastor, and it took me back a little bit. He was asking the pastor, if we have a God who made us and knows us, but doesn't need our acknowledgement of that, why do we worship him? Why do we pray? God doesn't need that. And the pastor's response was a little surprising to me. His response was he didn't necessarily believe that every single word in the Bible was God's holy word, but he believed that the concepts of the Bible were principles by which we live, and that in his worship, his singing, his praying, his life, his worship, was his way of saying he's committing to those principles. And I was shocked. I'm like, this is a pastor in our church, in our nation. But I thought, if a pastor in our country believes that, maybe some of us believe that. I don't know. So I wanted to ask you this morning, why do you worship? I'm just going to ask you to call it out. Why do you worship? Love it.
Since he's worthy.
He's the only one worthy of it, okay? No other reason but he's worthy. I'm sorry, who else said something? To give him glory? To express our faith? Say it again. Because that's how we are created. It's part of our very makeup is to worship him. To express our love. Because he's our Savior. He's our Father. We were talking about this in our worship prayer time, and Micah was saying, how would Bethany feel if he only kisses her on Sunday morning? Yeah, just an overwhelming lavishing of our love to our Father in gratitude, but also just building relationship, right? We don't just worship on Sunday morning. We do it together on Sunday morning, right? But our worship is in our life. It's in our conversations. It's in our time in his word. It's in our praise and our singing as we're driving in the car. So I just wanted to remind us, that's why we're here this morning, so we can do that together as a family, to show him our gratitude, to say, God, if for no other reason, you're worthy of it, right? If you do nothing else for us than what you've already done for us on the cross, you are worthy of our praise and adoration. So let's do that this morning.
Down on a spring. strong like a river. Your love is running through all my fountains are in you. Thank you.
that can tame me, this crazy love. Oh, what can separate us from your love, this crazy love.
Your love, this crazy love.
And trying harder, working more can help us to earn your love or can give us a better standing in your eyes. But God, you love us with an unconditional, everlasting love that's not dependent on us. It's not dependent on what we do or how we behave. God, you simply are drawing us deeper into that love. You, by the power of your Spirit, you want to transform our lives. You want to just wreck our world and make us into something that, God, we could never even imagine being by the power of your love. And so God, I pray for each and every person in this room that as we walk through this time together, that you would continue to imprint on our hearts the depth of your love. By the power of your Spirit, may you transform how we see the world, how we see ourselves, how we see you. God, help us to be drawn into place of incredible intimacy with you. So right now we pray and we continue to pray that you would have freedom to move in this place, that our hearts and our minds and that our ears and that our mouths and that every part of our bodies would be surrendered to you, that God, you can do what you want to do. We know that it's our attitudes, it's our disbelief, it's our lack of trust in you. It's our focus on ourselves. It's our own religious behaviors and religious efforts that keep us from giving you the freedom to do everything you want to do. So God, would you break down those walls today? And would you draw us into such an incredible place of intimacy with you that you change who we are? Thank you for your patience with us. Thank you for your incredible love for us. Thank you, God, that you care about our lives and what's happening. And we have such a long list of people who are hurting and going through difficulty. We just want to lift them up to you. God, I'm sure there's so many more than even are written on the paper I hold in my hands, because, God, so many people in this room have needs and hurts and struggles and feeling defeated and feeling broken and feeling distant. So God, right now, we just want to just lay our burdens at your feet and entrust them to you. Pray especially for Brittany, John Freem's niece, as she continues to be in critical care with these blood clot issues and seizures she's been having. Pray for Bruce Hill, as he continues to recover from this surgery to get rid of the kidney stones he's struggling with. Continue to help him to recover, be near him. Pray for Sandy Schroll as she continues to undergo treatment for this cancer that they've recently found. And would you be near her and encourage her and John and their entire family? Pray for Linda Rentschler and her family as they grieve the loss of Linda's mom this week. God, we are so grateful for an incredible godly woman that she was. And thank you for the promises of your word that we know that she is with you. Thank you for the celebration that happened recognizing that. For Bill and Karen Fenstermaker and their family and the death of their brother-in-law this week. Father, would you surround them with your love, your presence, and may the power of the gospel transform the grief that's in that situation to hope. Father, we pray for Dave, boyfriend of Cindy Wise. He's in the hospital with diabetic issues and faces a possible amputation. We just pray that you'd be near him. And Cindy asks that God God, for this time here. We pray that you would move in a mighty way the rest of this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Person who keeps all the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's laws. For the same God who said, "You must not commit adultery," also said, "You must not murder." So if you murder someone but do not commit adultery, you have still broken the law. So whatever you say or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law that sets you free. There will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when he judges you. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thanks to Wayne for reading God's word for us. And men, we're so grateful for your leading our hearts in worship as we seek the Spirit of God's moving in our presence here this morning. So we do want to continue our series in the book of Malachi. I have thoroughly enjoyed this minor prophet as God led me to this months ago, almost a year ago now. I wasn't expecting what we've run into. And today again, I'm just blown away by God's revelation of his heart. And so I wanted to dive into Malachi chapter 3. Before we do that, I was just praying and ask God to speak to us this morning. Father, as we open your word this morning, we want to hear from you. God, would you be our teacher? I believe you have something for our hearts today. Would my words be few? Would your words be many? Father, would your spirit be our speaker this morning? And may our ears be receptive to your voice. So speak now, we pray. Move in our presence. and transform who we are by your grace and your goodness and your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So yesterday I had an opportunity to spend the day in a little town called Wabash, Indiana. It's about an hour southwest of Fort Wayne. I was there speaking at a gathering of church leaders, teaching them how to do fresh expressions of the church. That's like what Triple Tree is, what our dinner church is, those kinds of things, the ministry at the Sportsman's Club, a number of things like that, where we intentionally move outside of our building to reach people who probably would never set foot inside the doors of a church. And as we were talking, you know, there's a section of the day in the training that I do that is really kind of discouraging. As we talked, we looked at some statistics and things like the one statistic from the Pew Research Center says this, that 20% of Americans attend church regularly. Only 20%. 20% say they attend church regularly, but they don't. They frankly lie. 20% say that they would attend church if somebody invited them, and 40% say that no matter what happened, they would never set foot in the doors of a church. 40% of our culture will never enter this building for any reason. And we can, as a church, we can either look at them and say, well, too bad for them, or we could say, what could we possibly do to go into their world and bring the good news of Jesus to them? That's what we're doing through our fresh expressions. But it's a disturbing number. Other disturbing numbers came out, like, for instance, in 2007, the Pew Research Center did a survey of Americans, and they found that 7% of Americans claimed they checked the box under religious affiliation. So, you know, there was Christian, there was Hindu, there was Muslim, there's Jewish. So all these religious affiliations. 7% of Americans said that they classified themselves as what's become known as nuns. In other words, no religious affiliation, not N-U-N. They haven't become Catholic with things on their heads. They claim no religious affiliation whatsoever. That number from 2007 to 2015 grew to 23% of Americans. And in 2015, the number of millennials who checked the box none, no religious affiliation, was nearly 40% of millennials. We used to, as Christians, have kind of what was known as the home field advantage. But we're living in something called post-Christendom, where no longer is Christianity, no longer is the Bible kind of in our country foundational to most of our culture. We are now a minority, not a majority. And sometimes when we look at those numbers, sometimes we look at those statistics, we can start to feel a little bit defeated. We can start to feel like the bad guys are winning. We can start to feel like, something is wrong. And we can do two things about it. We can sit and complain, and we can complain about things like sports on Sunday morning, and I've been guilty of that. And we can complain about our media, and we complain about this, or we can complain about that, or we can actually take action and say we're going to change things. We're going to be different. We're going to behave differently as Christians, as followers of Jesus, with intentionality to reach people who will never be reached by the church the way we're doing. Because that's what the gospel is, and that's what we've been called to do. But nonetheless, sometimes we feel like the wrong side is winning, and we feel like we're losing. Have you ever felt defeated like that? We often feel defeated in life. Sometimes it's religiously. Other times it might be our circumstances. It might be our job situation or lack of. It might be relational things. We often find ourselves defeated in life, and we feel like the bad guys are winning. The wrong side is winning. That's kind of like, as a Michigan fan, the rare times that Penn State actually beats Michigan. You know, I feel like the bad guys have won. Eagles fans may say that about the Cowboys or vice versa. But we often feel like the bad guys are winning, and that can kind of weigh down on us. And sometimes it's light and simple, and it's not that big of a deal. But the reality is, often in life, we live feeling defeated. It's a part of our existence. It's a part of humanity. But increasingly in our culture, we live as defeated people. And Malachi this morning is going to give us what I think is incredible advice on how to handle that defeated feeling. Last week, we ended with just this incredible place in Malachi chapter 3 where God says to his people, I want to bless your socks off. I want to do incredible things in your lives. I want to give you more than you know what to do with. And so we kind of left with this incredible feeling of, wow, isn't God good? Isn't God loving? Isn't God gracious and generous? And that's the God that we serve. And that's how God revealed himself to the people of Israel. But their response to that revelation was interesting. In verse 13, after God has said he's going to do all these great things, God says this, you have said terrible things about me, says the Lord. But you say, what do you mean? What have we said against you? You have said, what's the use in serving God? What have we gained by obeying his commands? Or by trying to show the Lord of heaven's armies that we are sorry for our sin? From now on, we will call the arrogant blessed. For those who do evil get rich, and those who dare God to punish them suffer no harm. So here's the people of Israel. They've just been told by God how much he loves them and how much he wants to bless them. And their response was, but God, look at everything around us. Like, you say you want to bless us, but it looks like the bad guys are winning. You say you want to do good in our lives, but it looks like the unrighteous are the ones who are being successful. They're the ones who are winning the battle. And we often feel like that as Christians, as people, and there are so many things that help us to feel defeated. And God's response through Malachi here is just sound advice on what we do when it seems like the bad guys are always winning. So he goes on in verse 16 and he says this, then those who feared the Lord spoke with each other, and the Lord listened to what they said. So that may not seem like much, but there's an incredible amount of truth packed into those words. What's happening? The people of Israel are complaining. They're upset that they're on the losing side. They're feeling defeated. So much of Israel is living in unrighteousness. We've talked about that. Their evil sacrifices, all the wrong things they're doing. And we expect that Malachi is all about judgment because of that. But God sneaks in and he points to those who feared God. He said, for all the negative we talked about, now I want to zero in on those of you who actually love the Lord, those who fear the Lord. And he says, those who feared the Lord spoke with each other. Now that's incredible advice. When you're feeling defeated in life, when you're going through difficulty and hardship, God says the godly talk to each other. They leaned on each other. When we go through hardship and difficulty in life, we need to recognize that godly friends are a gift from God. Here's the godly people. Here's those who are doing right and who are feeling like God is blessing the evildoers. They start to get together and talk. Now, we don't know what they talked about. It doesn't define their conversation, but probably they said to each other, things like, man, this is really hard. Man, you know, I know what God says, but it doesn't seem like that's reality. They probably did a little bit of commiserating together, but I suggest one of the things they probably did was encourage each other. They probably said to each other, because these are godly people, we got to remember that God loves us. We got to remember that God's on our side. We got to remember that we are selected and chosen children of God. God gives us, he brings into our lives godly people who can walk this journey with us, who can help us when we're feeling discouraged, who are there when we feel defeated, who walk with us as we walk through the trials and difficulties and hardships of life. Lean on, trust in the godly friends that God brings into your life. I love, Larry, that you, I know we'll pick on you till the time ends for your emotion. But like, how cool is it that Larry could stand up here and be moved to tears because God has given him a godly group of friends that he can live life with? Your godly friends become the people that God desires you to lean on, who are there to remind you of his love, to remind you of his goodness, to remind you of his presence, to remind you of his work in your life. And some of you are in the room and you're like, well, you know what? I don't have a lot of godly friends. I feel a little bit lonely. I feel like I'm doing this alone. Man, if that's true, that is so far from what God desires from you. If you desire godly friends in your life, I'd encourage you to just take just 30 seconds and look around the room. Here are a ton of people who want to be your godly friends. If you really want to take that seriously and get connected, soon as this service is done, walk out those doors, walk over here into the fellowship room, and we have all of our small groups in there who are saying, please come be a part of our group. We want to connect with you. We want to be friends with you. We want to be those godly people in your life who will walk through this journey with you. But God has given us godly friends as a gift. I love Proverbs 17. It says this, a friend is always loyal, and a brother is born to help in a time of need. God gives us these people to help carry us through our times of need. And not just other human friends. One of the most incredible statements in all of Scripture is that Jesus himself says, I don't want to be just kind of this distant, removed God, but I want to be your friend. John 15, you are friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends since I have told you everything the Father told me. God's desire is to carry us through and walk us through the difficulty, the hardship, the defeated moments of life when we feel like the bad guys are winning, when we feel like we're losing. And he does that partly by bringing us godly friends, but partly he does that by reminding us that he knows how we feel. He's with us. He goes on, it says there that those who feared the Lord spoke with each other, and the Lord listened to what they said. Man, sometimes in life we feel like we're alone, we feel like we're distant, we wonder where God is, and God wants to remind us that he knows us, he knows what we're going through, and he knows our circumstances. God heard what they said, and he had compassion on them. Can I tell you that God is always there with you? When you're feeling defeated, when you're going through hard times, God wants to remind you that he is always with you and he knows how you feel. And sometimes that reality seems like just kind of religious garbage. It seems like words that we throw around in church that really don't carry power or authority. And sometimes they become words that we have heard since our childhood, and we miss the weight and just the incredible value of the reality that God is always with us. He knows what we're going through, and he knows us intimately, and he cares. And so this morning I wanted to remind you of that in case you've forgotten. And so would you do something with me? It may feel weird to some of you, but I think Scripture talks about the power of God's Word simply falling on our ears and washing over our lives. And so I'd like you all to close your eyes. I know it seems weird, but I want you to close your eyes and concentrate on the words that I'm about to read to you from the Bible and allow them to sink deep into your heart. Oh Lord, you have examined my heart and you know everything about me. You know when I sit down or stand up. You know my thoughts even when I'm far away. You see me when I travel, when I rest at home. You know everything I do. You know what I'm going to say even before I say it, Lord. You go before me and you follow me. You place your hand of blessing on my head. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too great for me to understand. I can never escape from your Spirit. I can never get away from your presence. If I go up to heaven, you're there. If I go down to the grave, you are there. If I ride on the wings of the morning, if I dwell by the furthest oceans, even there, your hand will guide me. Your strength will support me. I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night, but even in darkness, I cannot hide from you. To you, night shines like day, and darkness and light are the same to you. You made all my delicate inner parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you, God, for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the darkness of the womb. You saw me before I was born, and every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. And when I wake up, you are still with me. Go ahead and open your eyes. If you ever wonder whether or not God is with you, if you ever wonder whether or not God cares about you, if you ever wonder whether or not God is in and part of the most intimate details, the most difficult circumstances, the feelings and emotions of defeat and despair that you're going through, know this, that God is there with you. He knows what you're going through. He knows every thought you think. He knows every feeling you feel. He knows you so deeply and intimately, and his desire for you and I is that we know him in that same way, with that same intimacy, with that same connection, with that same incredible love and passion. And God reminds his people that he loves them so deeply. He reminds the godly ones, those who fear him, that even though they feel defeated, even though they feel like the bad guys are winning, he says, no, I am with you. Trust that I've not forgotten you. He reminds them that he has not, nor will he ever forget them. I love this next verse, as he goes on here in verse 16. In his presence, a scroll of remembrance was written to record the names of those who feared him and always thought about the honor of his name. God says, I see you, I hear you, and I have written a reminder to myself of you. Sometimes we feel forgotten. I know for me, feeling that concept of feeling forgetful is like it's natural to me. I'm maybe one of the most forgetful people in the world. I have a sign in my office that says, some people say I have ADD, they don't understand, hey look, a chicken, because that's my life. Like, I am so easily distracted, I so quickly forget things, and I am so grateful that God has blessed me with a staff around me that is just phenomenal at kind of helping me navigate the details of ministry. Wendy and Karen and really the whole staff, just we work together well, and I'm so grateful because I can be so easily forgetful. And one of the things that I've had to learn in my life to kind of combat my forgetfulness is to write things down. I was so grateful for the invention of the iPhone, so I have something with me at all times to take notes, to remind myself of appointments and things like that. And it's comforting to me to know that God does the same things. He reminds the people of Israel that the godly ones, those who fear him, those who are following him, he says, look, I see you, I know what you're going through, and you got to remember this. I have written your names down in a book of record. You are there. I won't forget you. I've not forgotten you. You are mine. You are my dear children. Scripture is littered with reminders of God's sustaining and holding love, his remembrance, and his just incredible grasp that he holds on us. Romans chapter 8 talks extensively about God's love. The Apostle Paul says there, if we experience hardship, if we experience difficulty, if our lives are even threatened, does that mean that God has forgotten us? Does that mean that God has rejected us? Does that mean that we're no longer in God's control? And he says in verse 37, no, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ Jesus, who loves us. God will never forget you. And he has written your name in his book. But scripture goes further than that. One of the most amazing passages of scripture is found in Isaiah chapter 49. In Isaiah 49, the people of Israel are struggling. They say, yet Jerusalem says to the Lord, Lord, the Lord has deserted us. The Lord has forgotten us. And sometimes we feel like that, like God has deserted us and God has forgotten us. But I love what God says in response to that. Never. Can a mother forget her nursing child? Can she feel no love for the child she has born? But even if that were possible, I would not forget you. And I'm going to keep that next verse hidden for just a second. How many of you ever needed to remember something desperately? And it was so important to you that in order to remember, you took out an ink pen and you wrote a note on your hand. I used to yell at my kids, like, that's what you have paper for. Don't write on your hands. But sometimes, like, we really need to remember something, so we write a note on our hand, right? Listen to how desperately God loves you. Isaiah 49:16. See, I have written. I have written your name on the palm of my hand. Just let that sink in for a second. The God who created the world, we often say he holds us in our hand, but in Isaiah, he reminds us that his love for us is so incredible that he says, look here. There's your name, Mike Snedeker, right there, palm of my hand. Matt Culp. Denise Kaufman. Man, I could go through and list all your names. But God loves you so dearly. And he says, look, there's your name right there. And I will never forget you. And I will never let go of you. And no matter how much it feels like you're being defeated, no matter how difficult the road is you're walking, no matter how hard it seems right now, don't you ever forget that you are right there in the palm of my hand. Why? because I love you with an incredible love. I have chosen you. You are my treasure, he says. Verse 17, then they will be my people, says the Lord of heaven's armies. On the day that which I act in judgment, they will be my own special treasure. I will spare them as a father spares an obedient child. Then you will again see the difference between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. Please, don't ever forget that you are treasured by God. The literal words here is that we are the jewels of God, the precious diamonds, the precious jewels, the treasure of God himself. Is not this great big world, is not the soaring bald eagles that I talked about last week. And for those of you who are here at 11, how cool was it that we walked out of the service last week and there were two bald eagles soaring above our church? Like, that's just, that. I think that's just God saying, see, look how cool I am. But anyway, like, God is awesome. Like, he just shows off sometimes. But he says, all of this is nothing compared to you. Because you are my treasure. I love you deeply. I love you dearly. I love you intimately. Peter tells us we are not like that, for we are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he has called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. I love what Paul says to the church in Ephesus. But God is so rich in mercy. He loved us so much that even though we were dead in our because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. So God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness towards us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. Get the picture of what's here. You've read Philippians chapter 2. Jesus stepped down out of heaven. He gave his life for us. He died on a cross. He was buried. He was risen again. And God seated him at the place of honor, at the right hand of the Father, in the seat of glory, in the seat of honor. And Paul says, guess what? You are loved so deeply. You are loved so dearly. You are loved so intimately. You are so precious to God as his treasure that he also raised you and I and has seated us next to Christ at the right hand of the Father in this place of honor. Like, you wonder whether you're treasured, you wonder whether or not you are special to God. Jesus says, look, here I am next to the Father, and then there's this line of each one of us, brothers and sisters, co-heirs with Christ. You are treasured. Scripture is littered with passages. Isaiah 43, but now, O Jacob, listen to the Lord who created you. O Israel, the one who formed you says, do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I have called you by name. You are my own. Zephaniah chapter 3. Can any of you find Zephaniah real quick? Like, that's a tough one, okay? We got Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, Old Testament, couple books before this. But Zephaniah 3, God is describing his love, his passion for the people of Israel. And he's talking about how they often feel defeated and they often are feeling like their enemies are being victorious over them. But God says, I will chase your enemies away. And then he says this in verse 17, for the Lord your God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm your fears. And he will rejoice over you with a joyful song. Now, we walk into worship on a Sunday morning, and we love to sing. And I love what Karen had to say earlier, that worship is a part of our everyday lives. And one of the best ways for us to worship is to just sing to God. We just sing to him praises and glory. But grab this picture. Like, as much as we love God, God says, I love you. And Zephaniah reminds us that God himself is singing over us, pronouncing blessing upon us. The next time you feel defeated, the next time you feel like, man, like the deck is stacked against me, the bad guys are winning, Malachi reminds us that we are God's treasured possession. And what he desires of us is simply intimacy with him. As we close our time together this morning, just singing and worshiping, would you allow your hearts to not just sing a closing song? I know the temptation is like, okay, here comes the band, we're going to sing together. But in the same way we read that psalm with our eyes closed and our hearts just like totally focused on this enveloping love of God, can we just sing back to him in that same way? Let's pray together. God, we are so grateful for your incredible love. Thank you for choosing us, for selecting us, for making us your very own. And God, this morning as we close our time together, we simply want to worship you. You are worthy of our praise and worship. God, thank you for the way you delight in us and the way you treasure us. Father, teach us to delight in you, to treasure you, and to seek that same intimacy with our Creator. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Do what Mike said. Let's sing back to our Savior this morning.